and there was a warrant out for my arrest. Why? Because I went to address a meeting of lawyers down south in Palghar, where I attacked the phony nature of the emergency. Where I said that there has been no emergency of any kind in this country to call for the suspension of human rights. And ladies and gentlemen, I must also tell you that there were lawyers sitting with me on the stage. One by one, through my speech, each one left the stage and disappeared, because they knew that the state of things then were such that they will also invite a warrant for the kind of speech which I was uttering and they were hearing. But all dictators are also incompetent. I made my speech, I left Palghar, I came back to Bombay, then I went to Madras to argue some case in the Madras High Court. And the local commissioner of police telephoned to my wife that there's a warrant out for your arrest of your husband. And where is he? So she said, he's gone to Madras. So my wife called me up in Madras. And I told the commissioner of police, I said, tell the commissioner of police that Mr. Jethmalani will finish his arguments in Madras this evening and be sure that late in the night he will be here. And if you want to arrest him, please do. I returned that night. But ladies and gentlemen, India had still great judges at that time. And those judges were unfortunately in the high courts, but did not exist in that large numbers in the Supreme Court of India. 300 lawyers went to the judge in Bombay and obtained an injunction restraining the government from arresting me in the execution of that warrant. The commissioner of police met me and I told him, I said, listen, how come that you waited for so long for these lawyers to go there to the high court and get an injunction? He said, listen, you and I are friends. You have not been a criminal lawyer in vain. I know who you are, and I didn't want to arrest you, but I told that fellow from Palghar on the phone that how the hell do I know who you are? If you want my help in executing this warrant, come personally here. Let me first identify you. Let me see the genuineness of that warrant before I touch Mr. Jethmalani. In the meantime, ladies and gentlemen, and I must say that the period that I got, I used for the purpose of going around the whole country and talking about the phony deprivation of our human rights. And wherever I went, I remember meetings of lawyers taking place. And lawyers acquired a new energy because there was somebody who was quite willing to be arrested. And in spite of the fact that the matters had been taken to the Supreme Court, 9 judges in 9 high courts, or more than 18 judges in 9 high courts, had held that judges are not powerless and they can protect human rights even during the emergency. The matter went to the Supreme Court, challenging the validity of these judgments. And ladies and gentlemen, I too appeared in the Supreme Court because I was a free man under the stay order. And I appeared for a client. And I remember having opened my appeal by telling the 5 judges who sat there that, my lords, you will not be impressed by the fact that I'm appearing for one client who amongst hundreds is rotting in Indian jails. But what might impress you, that I am appearing for the millions and millions of other people who are likely to meet the same fate unless you protect their rights like the high courts in India are still trying to do. So I found that there was no response, at least not on their faces. So then I said, my lords, even this may not impress you, but now let me tell you that I'm appearing for all five of you. So that made the Chief Justice almost fall out of his chair. He said, Mr. Jethmani, did you say this? I said, yes, my lord, I said it. And I wish to repeat it. And for the next 5 minutes, I'm addressing you and not your brother judges. I said, Chief, have you heard of a country called Ghana? In Ghana, the Chief Justice of Ghana had helped the government to draft the preventive detention law of that country, only to draft that law. When that law came into force, the Chief Justice was the first to be picked up under that law. For 2 years, nobody heard of what happened to the Chief Justice. And after 2 years, there was a cryptic announcement in the press that the Chief Justice died of natural causes. I said, my lord, that's the fate which awaits all five of you. Indian democracy is not dead, though it is lying in the coffin. Even the government is ashamed to shut the lid of that coffin. They want you to do that dirty job for them. The question at the end of the arguments in this case will be, are you willing to oblige the government, or will you hold tight to your conscience? So, ladies and gentlemen, from that day onward, almost in every public meeting, I've always reminded my audience of that small little Urdu couplet, and my foreign friends will pardon me for not understanding Urdu, but it's a beautiful thing to say. Ke sitam ke daur mein wo ahle dil hi kaam aaye. Sitam ke daur mein wo ahle dil hi kaam aaye. Zabaan pe naas tha jinko wo bezabaan nikle. It is only the brave-hearted and the courageous speakers who help in times of tragedy. But the tragedy of the world is that those who are very proud of their eloquence have turned out to be tongue-tied when the situation called for free speech. I'm very happy that both the speakers before me have exercised their right of free speech to the full possible extent. And you set a new tone. In fact, when I came here, I didn't know what I'm going to speak about. But you have at least inspired me to say what I'm saying. Well, there is one thing which I wish to share with my foreign friends now. Your presence here must indeed certainly increased and improved the intellectual output of our discussions. It is said that the DNA stock improves when there is crossbreeding. Even the physiological mechanism improves in vitality and strength when you are not related within prohibited degrees of marriage. That same phenomenon takes place when intellectuals like you come from abroad and mix with our people. And I'm very happy that you have been able to spare 2 days of your valuable time. And I'm really, really grateful to you that you made this function a great success. And I must also compliment those who have conducted these 2 days operations by dividing into panels. Your output has been increased by 10 times. You have done 20 days work in 2 days that you have been at this job. My congratulations to you. I must particularly acknowledge the presence of my friend James, Mr. Duffy.
I will
certainly. He's a very distinguished member of the New York Bar. And ladies and gentlemen, I must confess that I have a special love for the Americans and for the United States of America. This doesn't mean that I love any other country less. Of course, there are some countries whom I love much less. But ladies and gentlemen, those who are represented in this place, in this meeting, have been. I love all of them. But to America, I owe another special date, which I wish to publicly acknowledge. The Supreme Court of India ultimately let us down. It overruled all the 9 high courts, and the disgraceful judgment of the Supreme Court, which I call it totally disgraceful, says that during the emergency, courts are totally powerless to protect human liberties. That judgment was delivered on the morning of a particular day at about 12 o'clock. And ladies and gentlemen, that evening in Bombay, in the house of lawyer Mr. Palkiwala, a few lawyers, 15 or 20, met in the evening. And I told them that I have called this meeting in your house only to tell you that I wish to leave India tonight. So he said, but you don't need our permission. I said, I don't need your permission, but I want one assurance from all of you that please do not accuse me of being a coward, that I'm going away out of cowardice. There are 102 lawyers in the city of Nasik jail. I'm quite prepared to be the 103rd lawyer in that Nasik jail. But I want to go abroad because I wish to talk about the demise of Indian democracy and the eclipse of it. And I wish to educate the people of India outside to get help in restoring the freedom of India. They said, you go. We will never, never accuse you of cowardice. But how will you go? I said, listen, don't ask me that question. I have not been a criminal lawyer in vain. I know how to go. So, ladies and gentlemen, that night I had to attend a wedding. The wedding was of that young man who is today India's Attorney General, Mr. Ghulam Banwati. His father was a dear friend, and I had promised that I'll attend his wedding. So on my way to the airport, I first went and attended that wedding. And while the Nikah ceremony was going on, I just whispered into his ear that, Ghulam, you may not see me for quite some time in this country. I'm going away somewhere. I don't know whether he understood what I was telling him. He was busy getting his new wife. But ladies and gentlemen, I was escorted to the plane. By whom? By no less a person than the Commissioner of Police Bombay. That's the advantage of being a criminal law practitioner. And ladies and gentlemen, I reached the country called the United States, and I am the first Indian who ever got political asylum in that country. I got the right to stay in that country. I got the right to make a living in that country. And ladies and gentlemen, I'm proud of the fact that nobody here introduces me as a law teacher. Everybody says he's a lawyer, he has become a law minister for a while. These are things of which today I'm almost embarrassed. Do you know today what are the latest jokes about lawyers? James must have heard about it. You read my friend Professor Galanter's, Mark Galanter's book on the collection of lawyers' jokes. Oh my God, you must read it. He's an American professor. And Mark Galanter's book contains one very significant joke, that the pharmaceutical laboratories in the United States have decided that in their experiments in their laboratory, they are now going to use lawyers instead of rats. So I said, my God, lawyers probably have some contribution to make to the growth of science. So I was not too ashamed of what Professor Gallanter had written. But then the pharmaceutical laboratories spelled out three reasons publicly why they had taken this decision. Reason number one, lawyers are more numerous than rats. Reason number two, more humiliating. It's difficult to fall in love with lawyers, as occasionally we do fall in love with our rats. The third reason was the worst. There are certain things which lawyers do which even rats will not do. So, ladies and gentlemen, for God's sake, don't keep introducing me as a lawyer and so on. It's enough that I make public confessions of belonging to that community. Out of sheer concern for the country, I got into another business, the business of being a politician. And I'm ashamed to say that politicians today are in a worse position of social acceptance than even the lawyers. I don't know whether you have heard the latest joke about politicians. No, my God, what are you doing here? One politician falls into the river and drowns. It will be a simple case of pollution. But if all politicians fall into the river and drown, that will be the solution. Please, for God's sake, I always appeal to my host that please introduce me not as belonging to any of these two professions, but please introduce me as a teacher of law. I must share with you a little story about my being a professor of law, because I have finished 72 years of legal practice